certainly more familiar with it than we are with Chinese, for example. That's enough to send a shiver down the spine of anyone who's even vaguely familiar with it. Even Arabic is far more complicated than we give it credit for. Whether it be English, Chinese, Arabic, Japanese, Hebrew, or any other alphabet, learning it has gotten more difficult, right? But it might surprise you to learn that only one of these is actually an alphabet, and that one's English. The term alphabet is not nearly as much of a far-reaching word as we give it credit for. The actual term for the written version of language is writing system or script. And it's also important to note, before we go on to talk about the convoluted syllabaries and semantic phonetics, the difference between language and script. It may seem obvious to you that language is what we write and, or language is what we say and script is what we write, but would you know that it's actually incorrect, or at least not specific, to say the English alphabet? What we use to write English is indeed an alphabet, as we've established, but it's not actually the English alphabet. Spanish and Italian use the same basic letters that we do, but it's not the same language that we speak. What we use to write English is actually the Latin script or the Roman alphabet. You're familiar with Roman numerals, we use the Roman alphabet. So we use an alphabet, so do Spanish, Italian, Dutch, and all those other ones with letters that we recognize. Does this mean that any language that uses a script with letters we don't recognize is not actually an alphabet? Not at all. An alphabet is a script that uses one specific character to represent one specific letter. You may be able to recognize Russian writing when you see it. This is an alphabet, but not the one that we use. The same goes for Greek. So what's an example of a script that's not an alphabet? I mentioned Arabic and Hebrew previously. These are both abjads. Abjads use one specific character to represent more than one letter. You may recall seeing dots, dashes, or the like spread out across these scripts, seeming to hang off of what looks like the main letter. More than likely, these are the vowels. Abjad vowels can hang off of the consonants that come before or after them, depending on the script. This allows the abjads to have more than one letter within the same character. But sometimes, vowels can be completely omitted, depending on the script that you're using and the purpose of your writing. These abjad vowels can be completely omitted and replaced with consonants which give the same general phonetic pronunciation to the word, thus avoiding going back and crossing all of your T's and dotting all your I's, just adding your vowels. Somewhat similar to abjads are abugidas. Abugidas also have vowels which rely heavily on the consonants surrounding them, but in a far different way. Some vowels never have to be written at all, no matter the purpose of your writing whatsoever. These abugidas have implied vowels, where if you see a K, you can automatically assume that you would write an A with it. If there's some sort of a change to the letter K, whether there's an additional mark or it's written differently, then that tells you what you replace the automatic A with. You may be familiar with Thai, Tamil, or even Old Persian cuneiform. These are abugidas. Okay, so we've learned about alphabets, abjads, and abugidas, but I mentioned previously syllabaries and semantic phonetics. What are those? Those are the fun ones. Syllabaries are similar to abugidas in format, but far more complicated to learn. Think about the word itself. Syllabaries. Sounds like syllables, right? Well, that's essentially what syllabaries are. Scripts that use one specific character to represent an entire syllable. These scripts include hiragana and katakana, two different scripts used to write Japanese. These scripts use the same amount of space to write the word through as they do to write a, I, or the, because all of these words are one syllable. This seems incredibly efficient until you think about the amount of phonetic combinations that a language can use. This makes it incredibly complicated and difficult for a bilingual to learn a syllabary, and it's hard even for native speakers to master. All of this information and so much more can be found on omniglot.com. It's an incredible resource if you have any questions about a certain script. But you may be wondering when I'm going to talk about hieroglyphics, because surely those are alphabets, right? I mean, they only use one character, and they only use one letter or space. Well, not exactly. The Egyptian hieroglyphics that you're likely thinking of are actually semantic phonetics. So is Chinese. This means that they take the meaning of their letter and character from more than just phonetics originally. They come from pictures or images or sometimes even cultural significance. You're probably familiar with the way this works in Egyptian hieroglyphs. The drawing of the lion represents an L, for example. The same for Chinese. These complicated characters that you're used to seeing originally shorthand that's being used today is only vaguely representational of what it used to originally be. Great, so now you know the different kinds of scripts. So what? Now it's important to know how our brain reacts to them. As English speakers and readers, we're familiar with the alphabet, but Spanish, for example, uses variations of different letters that we don't have variations of, such as the N with the tilde, the little squiggly line on the top. When I was first introduced to this non-English letter, the structure seemed entirely foreign to me. Does this kind of thing occur in other scripts as well? Here she addresses this. She references a test that was conducted with early Chinese readers to see how well they were able to pinpoint familiar, altered, and even non-existent Mandarin characters. She states in her article, the results that showed children can become aware of ill-formed structure early and become aware of well-formed structure but non-real components as they grow older. No wonder I thought that was strange. Another test was conducted to see how the brain responds to Roman letters versus Chinese characters. Alan Wong states in his article, while the majority of non-Chinese readers had no selectivity for Chinese characters at all, some showed activations for Chinese characters at locations in the brain similar to those selected for Roman letters. These results suggest that both stimulus properties and experience are important factors in determining the response to single characters across writing systems. So apparently the brain reads the same way no matter what it's reading. Maybe reading is actually the same across the spectrum. Not limited to this, however, there was another test that was conducted to see how the brain writes different scripts. This addressed kana and kanji, two different scripts used to write Japanese. Kana is a syllabary, while kanji is semantophonetic. It's the Mandarin version of Japanese. It's a semantophonetic, which means it takes its origin more from pictures and drawings than any other type of script. So while the brain should direct kana to generally write the same way we would write a word in English, the test wants to know how the brain would write kanji since it's originally a drawing. Kimihiro Nakamura addresses this. The function of writing, irrespective of the script type, is achieved by common brain structures used for a wide variety of lip movements. So not only does the brain read the same way, apparently it also physically reacts to different scripts the same way. But how does this affect our understanding of other academia, such as mathematics? Maja Rodrick addresses this. She hypothesizes that different scripts can affect the way a student understands math. She states, spatial complexity of the character-based writing system may reflect or lead to cognitive advantage relevant to mathematics. The conclusion of the test concluded that 1 year of script learning does not actually advance the student in math, but the fact that this test was conducted in the first place shows the thought process of professionals, one that scripts affects us in more ways than we might originally anticipate. For example, Christian Doble addresses another test that was conducted. This test revolves around our direction of bias. If you pick up an American comic book, you'll naturally read it from left to right. But a Japanese comic book, even one fully translated into English, will be read the other way around. The test concerns this idea. Children and adults were taken from both Germany and Israel and presented with information. The test